Hi guys, welcome back to my channel Gynaec Goddess. Today we are going to discuss operative vaginal delivery with forceps. So this is a paired instrument which is used to assess the delivery of the head of the fetus during the difficult normal vaginal delivery. So it has a handle, shank, lock and blade. So it's a paired instrument where you can release the two blades and you can lock them. It's a fixed lock, you can't slide the lock, it's a fixed lock, and this blade has two curves and there is a fenestration inside. So it has a pelvic curve and a cephalic curve. So there are various versions which differ from each other by some features like a length of the blade and fenestration, presence or absence of the fenestration, type of the lock, whether it is sliding lock or a fixed lock. Presence or absence of the pelvic curve. Forceps are mainly divided into two types, non-rotational forceps and rotational forceps. So there are few examples of non-rotational forceps like Neville Ban, Simpson, Pipers, Wrigley's, Negley's, and rotational forceps like Keelan's, Tucker, Maclean. So what are the difference between the two types, non-rotational and rotational forceps? In non-rotational forceps, there is a more pronounced pelvic curve. So this curve is more pronounced and there is a fixed lock. The lock is fixed. It can't be slided. Whereas in rotational forceps, there is a less pronounced pelvic curve. So pelvic curve is less pronounced and there is a sliding lock for the adjustment for rotation. What are the indications of putting the forceps? So when there is maternal indication like prolonged second stage of the labor, there is maternal exhaustion. Maternal medical conditions where the rest should be given and we should not strain the mother much. Like myasthenia gravis, any cardiac disease. So with every contraction of the uterus, there is a more cardiac output, more load on the heart. So we have to reduce and shorten the second stage of labor. So in myasthenia gravis and cardiac diseases, severe hypertensive disease or proliferative retinopathy, any cerebral aneurysm are some of the indications where we use the outlet forceps delivery to shorten the second stage of labor. And even there are fetal indications like fetal malposition when there is suspected fetal compromise where we have to deliver the baby as soon as possible, or we can use the Piper's forceps for after coming head of the bridge. So these are the indications for using the forceps for the delivery. What are the contraindications? Contraindications are, we should not apply the forceps when the cervix is not fully dilated. If we put forceps when the cervix is partially dilated, then it leads to the serious cervical lacerations and traumatic postpartum hemorrhage. So we should avoid putting the forceps with partial dilatation or when there is no full dilatation. And in non-vertex deliveries, but there are few exceptions like face presentation which is mento anterior position, and after coming head of the breech where we can put the Piper's forceps. And there is no mechanism for delivery in mento posterior position, so here the outlet cannot be put. And other conditions are osteogenesis imperfecta of the fetus, or risk of neonatal infections are there. When the head is not engaged or when we are not sure of the fetal position. So these are some of the contraindications while putting the outlet forceps delivery. So there are different types of forceps, outlet, low, mid, high. So we are concentrating on the outlet. When do you put an outlet forceps? So fetal scalp should be visible without separating the labia, and fetal skull, it should reach the pelvic floor, and sagittal suture, it should be in the anterior posterior diameter of right or left occipito anterior or posterior position. And fetal head is at or on the perineum. So this is called as outlet. This is the time where we put the outlet forceps. So what are the prerequisites we have to take, we have to follow? First, there should be informed consent. The patient should be informed and we have to take the consent, written and oral, and the head should be engaged, cervix will be fully dilated and membrane should be ruptured. adequacy of the pelvis. Even before progressing the delivery, while progressing the delivery, we already check the adequacy of the pelvis, but just once again we have to check the adequacy of the pelvis while putting the outlet forceps. Vertex presentation and the fetal position should be known, and adequate analgesia should be given, bladder should be emptied, and we should do all this under the strict aseptic conditions. And episiotomy should be given if the risk of perineal laceration is there, if it is a primary and the perineum is very rigid, then if there is a risk of perineal laceration, then we should give a episiotomy. And experienced staff should be there, and neonatal resuscitation staff should be present, and facilities for cesarean delivery should be present in that hospital where we are putting the outlet forceps in. So I'll show the demonstration of how to put the outlet in our next video, because I don't have the pelvis right now. So that's all for today, guys. Thank you for watching this video. If you like this video, please like and share this video, and don't forget to hit the like button and bell button. Thank you so much.